Better block. Now, before we move on to the kangaroo tours, let's talk about State of Origin football. I had my first camp in 95. You had yours in 1984.
84.
Like, how did you find out that you were picked?
I got a phone call from Keith Barnes, and I was thinking, this has got to be a G up. It'd be one of the boys, you know. I suppose a lot of people think about that sort of thing. And I was around at my wife's place with her mum and dad and all that and got the call. And, wow, mate, it was the biggest buzz ever, because State of Origin at that time, although playing test football was the biggest thing for me because we'd grown up watching all the tests and all that. But to get picked, first thought into my mind, do I belong here?
Yep.
That was the hardest part to overcome.
People will find this hard to believe, but walking into your first rep camp, when you walk in, it's terrifying.
It is.
Because you're thinking to yourself, what are these blokes thinking about me? Should they be? Are they thinking this bloke's an imposter? Should he have been picked?
Yeah.
It's like your first day of school when you walk in.
And then we walked in, and all of a sudden our first camp is when, you know, Sterling and Kenny and all those sort of guys, all those sort of guys, Eric Groth, they were great blokes. After a night out, one of those bonding nights, straight away you get on well, you know.
Right, tell me, Kenty, what was your... Tell us about the bonding night.
Well, the bonding nights back in, the ones that I barely remember, we used to play pub golf in Balmain.
Barely remember.
Explain that for the listeners.
Well, pub golf was you went in every pub, and there was a par in every pub. So there's 19 pubs in Balmain back in those days. So, and I might add before I start, no one ever finished. So we'd have the leaderboard, the green jacket. So everyone had the green jacket. We walked in. I think I can remember one time we went in there, and it was a par three.
So three schooners?
Yeah, three schooners to be on par. But some blokes would try and go hard, big zero and all that. They'd go five schooners in the first pub. So they're two under. And on the leaderboard, just to get their name on the leaderboard and get the green jacket. I reckon we only last nine pubs.
Yeah, right. That's still pretty good going.
Mate, it was horrific. Yeah. It was horrific seeing, the state of some of the blokes. But it was good in the way of blokes that you'd never met. And, you know, because you go into your first camp, as you said, and you're thinking, mate, do I belong here? And then all of a sudden you meet those guys, and at the end of the day they become lifelong friends. Like Eric Groth, for instance. One of the quietest blokes I've ever met, but one of the best blokes, he'd get his guitar out and start singing.
Yeah.
Do you know what I mean? So, just seeing all that sort of side of all these great players. When I was growing up, Arthur Beetson and Craig Young were my heroes. Craig Young was a Wollongong bloke. That's why I really looked up to him. So my first State of Origin is in Queensland at Lang Park. And he's in the front row with me. So I was thinking more of not letting him... seeing what he thought of me when you're playing, rather than worrying about Queensland.
Impressing him.
Which was probably a good thing. But I remember the kickoff. He took the first hit up, and Dave Brown hit him with an elbow. That was back in those days when you could do all that stuff.
Yep.
And I remember the bloke coming on with the sponge and that. I was spraying it on him, going, wake up, mate, Jesus. I'll be stuck here on my own, you know. But, it was unbelievable to play in those games. And When you look at money, sort of didn't even come into it, you know. Just thinking about the honour of playing for New South Wales after you'd seen how it all started in 1980 with Arthur and Tommy and all those sort of guys. So, big buzz, your first one. And once you get the first one out of the road, every origin for mine that I ever played in or ever watched now breathes its own life. It's all different.
Yeah.
And, and then playing in your second one at home is a little bit more comfortable.
Who was your roommate?
My roommate, my first origin, probably Bouncing Benny, I think. I roomed with him a few times. There were a few blokes that you tossed the coin that you didn't want to room with.
And who were they?
But, it was great times. And, just to sit down and listen to those guys. By that time, Parramatta had won a few premierships and all that sort of stuff. Sitting down and listening to them about how they thought about the game and how they played, and that was, you learnt so much just off so many people, you know. It was good.
We were in the first one in 95, and there was no – I remember myself and Andrew at Mum and Dad's house, Cessnock, and it was a press conference. There was so much going on with the Super League War that basically we sat and watched the press conference live to see if we were going to get in. There were two things going on. Were they going to pick the Super League players? And then secondly, if they're going to pick ARL players, where we're going to get in.
Yeah.
And I remember the Mullins was, I think, the incumbent for New South Wales, possibly. Anyway.
He would have been cut off 94. So.
94.
Yeah.
And so everyone's waiting for the first name out of Arco's mouth.
Yeah.
And he went, Brasher. And you went, okay, they're not going to pick Super League players.
Ooh.
And then, you know, then they went, Matthew Johns, Andrew Johns. So, it was, you know, I tell you, it was really interesting going in because I looked back, I wasn't ready. I wasn't ready for it. Like, I'd had, firstly.
There's only one way to find out.
That's right. And looking back in hindsight, I'd done my knee. I was out for a medial ligament for 5-6 weeks.
Yeah.
I'd just come back. But I tell you what it was, I wasn't ready. I wasn't ready for the pressure. I wasn't ready for the build-up and how crazy it is. And I wasn't ready to handle the expectations of us being red-hot favourites.
Mm. Yeah.
Mm.
And the other thing I wasn't ready for, you know, they oftentimes say you need to play, you know, you need to play an origin, you know, two or three to start to get used to it.
Mm.
I reckon it takes you a few to get used to the hype and to take your preparation into camp.
Mm.
And that first one we went into, like, I remember by – it was a 10-day camp. And I remember day four, we're still drinking.
Yeah.
And I'll be thinking, I wouldn't
– I don't usually do this.
I don't usually do this. I wouldn't be doing this at Newcastle. And you're really conscious of the blokes around you, trying to impress blokes like, you know, like Freddie and all the blokes.
Yeah.
So once the training session ends, where you normally go and do extras, you go, oh, I'm not going to do it.
Cause,
you
know, they I'm might, going back to bed.
They might laugh at me too, you know.
Yeah.
So it was interesting.
But what about playing with your brother? Did that take any –
Well, it was through everyone. There was so much hype about, you know, it was the Blues Brothers and Front Page. And mate, you learn to sometimes, again, comes back to your preparation, but to say no. When someone says, oh, we want to get another photo, to say no. Like, I remember every single day we're doing interviews and photos. And mate, by the time the game came, we're worn out.
Yeah.
And it was interesting, the dynamics of the side.
That was part of the sales pitch ARL back then, though, too, Matt, if you remember.
Yeah.
Because that was a big part of the Super League war was, okay, well, they haven't picked Super League players, picked the side that you guys are in.
Mm.
So it was not just the game. That Origin series was not just about that series.
Mm.
That, there was bigger things at play that year. And, you know, I think, you know, you guys were salesmen in some ways of the game. I remember Gould used to talk up you and Joey every day, and it was always like, mate, I don't know what they're talking. They're making noises at each other. They're clicking and all this. But he just really just –
It was to ramp it up.
He filled – it was a sell.
And I saw there were a couple of players that started to resent it.
Yeah.
I remember one of the players who was on – who played in my spot, he got interviewed and they said, mate, what are you looking forward to? And he said, well – He goes, I suppose, you know, it's playing with those two brothers. That's all they want to talk about. And then I remember, you know, the Denny Seaford tradition.
Yeah.
Where you go there and Denny Seaford, a couple of funny things there. We turn up there and, mate, let people know the scampi and lobsters coming out.
Oh.
And, mate, I'd never eaten lobster in my life. But they got there and I turn up, I'm starving, and they put the garlic bread down.
Rookie era.
Chief goes, don't eat the garlic bread.
Don't eat the garlic
and
bread.
And I'm hiding it from Chief and eating it. But what I remember that at that dinner, it was really awkward because, you know, you're really sensitive to people around you, things you're saying in those early camps. There was a player there and he sort of started to say a few things about Joey Chief and I, the Newcastle blokes. Like, oh, mate, yeah, it's Newcastle blokes. And, you know, anyway, he pointed to a lobster and he said, mate, look at the head on it. It must be from Newcastle.
Ooh, Chief wouldn't handle that too.
We all sort of looked at each other and we said, is this bloke... Is he joking?
Yeah.
And then, mate, the kicker came. He looked at us and just said, mate, and just went, hey, boys, got a question for you. What's it been like living under power lines your whole life?
Ooh, that's fighting words.
Anyway, we all sort of looked at each other. Fair play to Terry Hill. Terry Hill walked over, said, outside.
Yeah?
Yeah.
And said, walked, took him outside and said, mate, listen, you know, you want to keep carrying on, I'll iron you out.
Yeah, and he would.
Yeah.
Can we get back to the garlic bread?
Andy did.
Andy did. It was a rookie error and I knew it, but I couldn't resist, Matthew. Know. You know when they brought it out and that? Yeah, rookie error was.
You don't seem a man of great discipline.
But no, they're bringing out all the they're bringing out all the lobsters and everything later, but I say, don't eat the garlic bread and all that, and then they, You get a woof of it.
Oh, mate.
Mate, you couldn't help yourself.
Only half finish your lobster.
Exactly. See all the seafood left over and that? Oh. We felt like a pig, you know, all the other people in the restaurant. Remember they used to get people would sit her outside. They'd run a competition and people would come.
Yes.
Just to see the boys picking it out on the seafood. Yeah.
That, on game night, and we were massive favourites, a couple of things struck me. Was Spud. Was in the, and I used to call it Spud's double demolition. Yeah. So he used to get an injection into his big toe. So what he used to do to pump himself up for the injection, he used to demolish the dressing room and, you know, start headbutting
the walls and all that stuff.
Okay, mate, that's weird. Then he get the injection. And then they do the 2-minute siren. So he's on in 2 minutes. He demolished the dressing room again. Mm. But, mate, remember that we were red hot favourites. I remember running on the field. And in hindsight, you're not even thinking about the game, basically, until the day before. There's so much going on. I remember standing on the Sydney Football Stadium and I looked around at my teammate, Robbie O'Davis, and the way he ran onto the field, I thought, we're in trouble here.
Yeah, they were pumped.
Kenty, tell me about the time. And the press oftentimes with Origin camps have a problematic relationship, but Gus invited you into camp once.
Yeah, what it was about, Matty, it was during the whole bonding exercise thing and whether they were necessary, because players have been playing up a little bit on the nights out. I get the bonding exercise and why you do it, because guys, as you said, don't know each other, block, sit down, have a few beers, they relax, and those hostilities that develop as rivals, they begin to melt away. And I understood that. So I said to Gould one day when there was a lot of kickback on the Origin bonding nights, and I said, look, let me come in, write about what happens, and just take the stigma out of it. Just let everyone just... And I first put it to Jeff Carr. Jeff Carr said, let me talk to Gus. Anyway, so I waited a couple of days for him to talk to Gus. He didn't get back to me. And then finally I grabbed him one day and I said, listen... Any word? He said, no, not yet. So I saw Gould. I thought, you know, I'm just going
to ask him.
So I went out. I said, listen, mate, told him my pitch. He said, yeah, mate. He said, we'll be at the Clovelly. We've got a training run. He said, then we'll be at the Clovelly at 7 o'clock. Be there at 7. He said, and the rest of the night, you're on the bus. You're with us. And I said, right, that's sweet. Carrie walked past. Kenty, I just spoke to Gus. Sorry, mate. I said, well, Carrie.
I've just spoken to him myself.
Yeah. So I don't know what he told you. Yeah. But anyway, so I went out that night, and it was. Look, there's not a lot happens. It was that most young blokes don't do.
Yeah.
Sat around having a few beers because it was, I think it was a Wednesday night. It was a quietish night in the pub. Sat around. Has this game. Laurie Daly had this game he likes to play with all the new guys in, and Laurie's sitting there and he's, you know, asking questions, and guys are sitting around. It's a bit of an honesty session to get to know each other. So basically telling embarrassing stories about yourself, but the beer just kept coming and coming, and blokes are getting half. Some handle it better than
others. By the way, some of those stories you go...
Oh, 100%.
No.
Mate, no, you do the old life. Nothing weird about that.
Yeah, doesn't everyone do that?
Mate, one of them still haunts me.
I know.
But I will not go into that. But that's and that was the night. You know, one of the players got a bit crook and had a bit of a spew. It was like I got a dessert bowl and just turned it upside down. I just remember looking at it thinking, man, this is heavy.
That's a bad
and
night.
But that was it. And then we kicked on there to... after telling story, playing a few gambling games with coins and stuff. Then we kicked onto the Coogee Bay, and it was starting to get, I think, about 2 or 3 in the morning at that point. And I was like, mate, I've got to go. And Mark O'Murley kept saying to me, mate, just stick around a bit longer. And I'm like,
Central Coast boys.
He's going, no, mate, no. He said, mate, the boys love having you. It's all good.
Yeah, of course like, they do.
Right. And anyway, so I thought, mate, I can't stay here any longer. So I just said, look, boys, I just got to go to Lou.
Back door.
You know, I go straight out the back door and I was gone. Anyway, so I go into work the next day. We're sitting there and the boss calls me in. We're sitting there having a meeting about planning the paper for the day. And he goes, so what was last night like? And I said, well, it was really good, you know. And I was explaining a lot of the stuff we did. And get a knock on the door. A girl just sticks her head in. She says, had a phone call. We're all said, yeah. And she said, I know you're planning this Origin stuff. Someone's just rang and said last night that they've got a phone call saying fire up.
Oh,
I thought, mate, there goes my story. That was the end of it.
Yeah, right.
And after that, though, because of the backlash, it was the famous...
Fire up story.
With Gazny.
Oh, okay.
With Gazny. Yeah, I left 20 minutes before the phone call. Thank God I did, otherwise I'd be unemployed now. But that just changed the whole narrative after that.
It's after midnight, Paul.
Yeah, I know that. But look, I get it. I get all that as well. No. I'm not a prude in any, by any means. But that just changed the whole tone of things, Matty, because rather than this being a positive, Gould for 2 days said, I can't coach these guys. I can't do it. Young men are different from the young men I know. I can't do it. Then the Blues called him in and said, listen, mate, you got a job to do. You're going out to do it. So he then had to change the narrative a bit. And so what he did was, this is why you can't trust the media blokes. We had this bloke in here and look what they've done. And now, I never wrote the story. I never did any part of that.
You didn't even know.
Well, the media come the enemy.
But that's psychology, Matty. That's what Gus is great at. So what he did was he circled the wagons and basically they're all out to get us and used that to bring New South Wales closer.
You're right.
And that's the way. Look,
You're the poor guy for it.
I was. And I'll be fair, there was one player I got on particularly well with and after that it was never the same.
Yeah, right.
And I tried a couple of times, I said to him...
Try to say that...
Hey, everything all right, and he's totally non-confrontational. He's like, no, mate, I've got no issue, but he clearly did.